welcome to another edition of All Entertainment Live, the greatest, preeminent, most excellent show on radio. Prepare yourself for an hour of fun, great music, chats, and special guests. As the late, great Don Cornelius put it, you can bet your last money, it's going to be a stone gas, honey.
Do you want to play rough? Okay. No. Say hello to my little friend!
So without further ado, it's All Entertainment Live with your host, Jerry Hand and Adam Monaco.
Welcome to another edition of All Entertainment Live. I'm Jerry Hand. Adam Monaco is in the building. Hey, Adam.
Hey, how's it going?
Oh, my goodness. So it's been a pretty busy summer. Lots of hanging out. Tell me what you've been doing lately.
Oh, man. Playing shows, recording music. I finished a song that I've been working on for 8 years, which is really cool. And it's going to be in a documentary about Smarty Jones, the racehorse.
Smarty Jones. Yeah, I love Smarty. Yeah. Why? Is Smarty still alive?
No, yes, yeah. Oh, and they cool. actually went and filmed him. I think the directors asked me to send him a song. It was literally 2 days after I finished this. He's like, hey, I need a song, the blah, 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 blah. And I was like, how does this? And he was like, it's perfect. And I was like, okay, that's cool.
So
we'll see how that goes.
Another notch in your belt. Adam, for the folks that don't know, he's been writing stuff that's been licensed for things like movies, documentaries, and even like American Idol, right?
Yeah, that happened.
Yeah, yeah. So very you're random. At least a minor celebrity in our program. So today we've got a special guest.
Yeah.
And his name is Joseph Arnold, and he's got a book called Soulforce. But I'll tell you, it's so much more. He's so much more than an author. He's also a really great violinist, and he's sharing his presence on us today here in the studio 106.5 FM Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. Hello, Mr. Arnold. How you doing?
Oh, great, Jerry. I'm really glad to be here. Good to see you again, Adam.
Yeah. Yeah. So glad you're here.
Yeah, this is really fun.
Okay. You've been like spending a very long time on this book, like to sit here with you, and like I've just for you to give me a copy, I feel like it's just, I don't know. I'm like, I know what you put into it, and just to like hand this to me for free is like gold for me. Like, because I admire you so much. And so, and Joseph recorded on one of my songs, Nevermind. And he came in and recorded violin. He worked with Peter Oswald, and they worked together for some instrumentation in the bridge, like an instrumental bridge section. And it was, Joseph just killed it. And it was just beautiful. And so I'm just like, so stoked about
thank you.
I met Joseph at the Alon Salon. That's at right. At Harmony Hall. Our buddy Alon Isakov, and he had this big necklace on, and that was what drew me. I was like, "What's that necklace?" That was the start of our friendship, and then it was a necklace that he's not wearing it. I wonder if you gave it to someone, because you're supposed to pass it on to someone else.
I haven't done that yet. I'm too attached to it.
Okay.
I was going to say, if you're connected to the necklace, it's probably in a garbage somewhere.
No, it's...
I joke.
it was a beautiful necklace, and I forget, what's the story of the necklace again?
Well, I got it at a... one of these hippie music festivals, like wellness music festivals out west a couple years ago, and I saw one of the vendors. They had these beautiful pendants, really, that are laser cut, and they have these amazing like natural scenes or animals or sacred geometry on them, and I got one that has the scene of Alaskan moonrise. And it's glow in the dark, the moon is made out of lapis lazuli. It's this beautiful piece, and you're supposed to give it away. It's called a giving pendant, and each one has a serial number, so you, like, in theory, you could track it around the world if you wanted.
Oh, that's so cool.
But it's too beautiful. I don't want to give it away.
You know, I like necklaces just as much as the next guy, but we got a lot of ground to cover here.
No, I know.
Today.
I was just setting the stage here, Jerry.
Joseph Arnold. Let's talk about him and his life and his book.
Yes.
Great, yeah. Well, so I just wrote...
Wait. Oh. Tell us where, how did it started. Like, where are you from? Tell us about growing up. You know, you have any siblings?
Okay.
You know, just how you got started with music, you know, from a little young boy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I was born around here, but I grew up in California and also in Maine. We traveled around a bunch. And I have an older sister. I started playing violin when I was five. And some of my earliest and most cherished memories are being out in California and going to fiddle camp in the redwood forests. And it was just, it gives me chills even thinking about it now. Playing all these fiddle tunes, being this little kid, among these gigantic trees. It was so magical. And this was such a formative experience for me because it reminded me, gave this direct experience of how what music is supposed to do, what music is supposed to be like. It's this magical experience. And so that really got deeply inside my soul and has influenced me since then. After then, I went to music school in Pittsburgh. I went to Carnegie Mellon and studied jazz there. And that's really where I hit this major road bump that became... that really became the direction of the rest of my life. You know how they say the obstacle is the path, right? So this is one of those obstacles that became the path. So I was going to school for music, playing many hours a day, and it was just like I was like a machine practicing, for so many hours, and pretty soon I started to have pain in my forearms. And this was like a year into it. And then by a year and a half into it, I couldn't play violin anymore.
Wow.
I was in so much pain. And I saw doctors and therapists and myofascial people and chiropractors. And I saw a neurologist. I mean, I saw everybody. And none of them had really good answers for me. It was like a year later. I still didn't know why I was in pain. I could barely play. I could barely do my dishes. This was like the worst possible situation for a budding violinist, right? And then a friend of mine suggested I take this class called Alexander Technique at the college. And I had no idea what this was, but I thought, I've tried everything else. Why not try this? And I went into this class, and at first I had no idea what the teacher was talking about. She was saying stuff about my body. Oh, you pay attention to your body. Like, what? What does that have to do with music? I was so disconnected from my body, I didn't even know I had one. And yet, through that class, what I realized was that I was so used to holding all this tension in my body while I was playing, that it was like squeezing the violin, like squeezing, holding my breath, and tensing my face, and squeezing my legs. Like, why was I doing that while playing? There was all this unconscious stress and tension that I was carrying around with me that was, of course, causing this injury that I had. And through the Alexander Technique, I learned how to let go of all of that. And it was so profound. It completely changed like my comfort level, just holding the instrument and playing. I felt so much better in my body. It made playing so much easier. You think of like riding a horse, and if you have all that tension in your body during the creative act, it's like you're riding a horse and you're pulling on the reins at the same time as you're like whipping the horse's behind to get it going. It's like you're sending your body mixed signals, so you get all this tension. And so when I was letting go of that tension, my technique became so much more fluid, my sound opened up, my expressivity really opened up, the emotional energy that I had access to was magnified many times. And I mean, this really caught my attention for a lot of reasons, and has become something I explored very deeply in my life, and something that I've taught over the years to countless musicians and other artists, and has formed the basis of my book, because this creative energy that came forth through me and through my colleagues in the Alexander Technique School and in my students. Maybe I can share some stories about my students, because it's so remarkable. I mean, my heart just goes, oh, every time I think about it. But that creative energy, that's what I call soul force. And so maybe I'll tell a little story about that.
Yeah.
Let's hear the story.
Yeah, definitely. I'll tell a story here. So I was teaching a violin lesson many years ago to this young student. She was maybe 12. And she was playing one of her pieces in the lesson for me, going da 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 da, you know, in the way that kids, young kids do. And it was fine. She was getting the notes right, but it was kind of boring. And what the most amazing thing happened after she was playing her piece, she said, "Why does my music sound so robotic?" I thought, whoa, amazing self-awareness here.
What a great question. Yeah.
Right? And I was just so delighted because now we could start working on the stuff that actually mattered. Yeah. You know, getting the notes right matters, but if that's all you do, that's not music. It's just a sequence of sounds. Right? She was making a sequence of sounds. So I asked her. Well, so I had a couple things going through my mind. Like, I couldn't just tell her, oh, play louder here, play quieter here, do this kind of expressive technique, because even that could sound mechanical, right?
Yeah.
And so I needed to get her in touch with a deeper source of creativity within her. And so I asked her, how do you know, when you listen to a piece of music, how do you know that you like it? What tells you, oh, I like this piece of music? So I'll ask you too. When you hear something you really like, when you really don't like it, what tells you that?
Oh, man. You first, Jerry. Smart guy.
Why are you chickening out of this one? So, for me, it's, I guess it's like a visceral kind of reaction.
Yes.
You kind of know it when you hear it.
That's
type
right.
thing.
That's right.
Yeah.
And what kind of visceral thing happens for you?
You know, just something that you kind of feel down deep in your soul.
Yeah.
I you know, it's not something to me that's too quantifiable. I know you've got like, you know, the top 10 list and all that stuff. I never go by that to determine what I like. I know a lot of people do, but
That's right.
You know, for me, you know, if I like it, if I really feel it in my bones, then you know, I'm going to tell the world, you know.
Yeah.
And hopefully they'll like it too, and then, you know, whoever recorded it can, you know, make some money. But
Yeah.
So that's exactly right on that visceral experience being in your bones. It's an embodied thing. Yeah. Go ahead, Adam.
Well, yeah. No, I was thinking about this yesterday. Mm. I was just like, why do I just listen to something sometimes and I'm just like, oh, I love this. Like,
exactly.
What is it? And the thing that's happening, I wonder, like, could someone else can listen to it? Like, there's also that thing of like you not really getting something out of something, but then the person next to you is like, oh, like I get this, you know? And like, I just wonder, is that person tapping, like, are they tapping into that soul force, you know? Or like, I don't know. Yeah, it's just like wonder about that.
Well, well, maybe I'll finish the story and that'll become clearer.
Cool.
So I asked her what she felt or how she knew that she liked a piece of music. And she said, well, it makes me feel happy. You know, I feel more open. I feel like I want to dance. And that's exactly it. So what I say, you know, like Duke Ellington was known for saying, if it sounds good, it is good. What I say is if it feels good, it is good. Because listening to music or really any art appreciation is as much an embodied experience as an aural or visual one. You know, if you're a visual artist. And this really is where the emotions live. Right, and your emotions happen in your body, and what I realized in that moment was that she wasn't in her body at all. She wasn't connected with her emotions at all while she was playing this. She was all up in her head, focusing on the concept of the notes, the little dots written on the page, the intellectual experience of these are the notes I have to play. Now I mechanically move my arms to play them. Right, and that's what it sounded like. It sounded like she was trying to get the notes right. So there's a really important principle right there. What you pay attention to, what you think about during the creative act, comes through in the creative act.
Hmm.
And so I knew I had to get her to pay attention to something else. And so I asked her to pay attention to what I call the inner audience member, that part of you that feels something when you hear something, when you see something. Right, it's the emotional energy that's in your body. And this is your inner aliveness. And so I asked her, well, just pay attention to that. Simply notice your inner aliveness, your inner audience member, the emotional energy of your body for every note that you play. And the difference was unbelievable. Instead of da 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 da, it was da da dun, da, 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 ya, da, da. It became real music.
It's what she wanted to hear. It's She's playing what she wanted to hear.
Right? Yeah. And I heard her coming through for the first time. Her energy. Now, her youthful self came through in the music. I might just get tingles just thinking about this. And this is what every artist wants to experience in the creative act. This is what I call soul force. This is what every audience member wants to experience, right? And so my book is about how to tap into that in every situation in your life as an artist.
And speaking of the book, we're talking to a really, talk about an expert. He's written 450 pages about this stuff. So he knows his stuff.
Yeah.
And we want to get into the book Soul Force. But before that, Mr. Arnold's brought his violin.
Oh, yeah.
And we'd like to hear him play something here live in the studio. Hang on a sec.
Yeah, I'll play just a little snippet from one of my compositions. This one's called Jazz Fantasy Number 2.
Jazz Fantasy Number 2 by Joseph Arnold. That's pretty amazing.
Thank you.
So, Joseph, are there any other artists that you admire, that you look up to, any that have influenced you in your career?
Oh, my goodness, so many. You know, the first one who comes to mind is Gerardo Nunez, who is a flamenco guitarist. And he's recorded several albums, and it's like some of the most beautiful music I've ever heard. It's just jaw-droppingly beautiful, especially his album called Kalima, C-A-L-I-M-A. It's called, translates as heat. And I mean, he to me, he's like the perfect musician in a sense, because he has like unbelievable technique, but the technique is never disconnected from the deepest soul. Like he plays, you know, beautifully, cleanly, but the grooves are so deep, and these compositions just, you know, bring tears to my eyes every time I listen to them. That was a very formative album for me years ago.
Talk about a visceral reaction. Yeah, for me, when I cry, you know, to a song, that means, you know, really, that means something to me. And So let's talk about the book, man.
Sure.
Soul Force. All right, how did you come up with that title, first of all?
All right, so right at the beginning of the pandemic, I was listening to this podcast with this one flow expert, Jamie Wheel, and he talks about flow states, but also existential risk, like what's going to happen to us all. And that's what the podcast was about. The hosts asked him, you know, what chance do we have, does humanity have, of surviving the next couple decades with the pandemic and political strife and climate change and everything? And he said, to me, it's either soul force or bust. I'd never heard this term, soul force, before, but I immediately got what he was trying to say. There's something deeper, some deeper kind of spiritual force that exists within us that is essential for helping us navigate these turbulent times. And I remember just being sort of awestruck listening to this. Well, like, wait, I wonder if that's the thing that I've been experiencing, you know, through the Alexander technique, and my students are experiencing this soul force. And I wonder if I could start a Soul Force Arts Institute and teach this to artists and musicians all around the world so that we can do something beautiful, make a beautiful, tangible contribution to our world, to our society and planet through our art. And yeah, so that all came to me right then. That's why I wrote the book. Like, oh, I want to know how to do that. I want to teach people how to do that.
Mm. Wow. That's like, I just love that, like, your mission is to help everyone be better with themselves. Like, that's what happened. You weren't like, oh, I got this. Let me just go and be great, which you are. But you're like, let me share this. Mm. And I want everyone to be great.
Yeah.
Which is awesome.
Yeah. We need it.
Yeah.
By the way, we've got some background music as you've been listening to the gentleman speak. And the background music has been composed and performed by none other than Joseph. So, this one's actually called Buttermilk Biscuits.
Yeah, that's right.
Buttermilk Biscuits? I mean, were you eating, like, breakfast or something when you wrote this?
You know, creativity works so funny. This is a great story, actually. So, I was driving in my beat-up Ford Taurus between D.C., where my sister lives, and Pittsburgh, where I was going to school at the time. And you know, there's the Blue Ridge Mountains through there, and there was no tape deck. The tape deck was broken. There's no radio because it's out in the middle of nowhere. And I was traveling in silence. And this is, for me, prime creativity time. And I got this complete download of this piece, Buttermilk Biscuits. It came, the whole thing, all at once. I knew exactly where every single note should go.
Wow.
And yeah, that happens every once in a while, right? This was a very clear experience of that. And as soon as I got to a place where I had cell phone coverage, you know, this was the days, but with dumb phones, right?
Yeah.
So I called up my friend and said, I have to sing something into your voicemail. let me call you back. And so I sang this piece into his voicemail. And then wrote it out. And at first I was calling it like a Blue, you know, Ridge Valley something song. But that was kind of boring. And then inspiration struck again, just out of nowhere. And you know, this is something I talk about in the book, in terms of like the creative process. Everybody has different things that they like to do, but I think the way I think of it, there are five phases to the creative process. There's putting in the hard work. There's the doing phase, and then there's the failing phase. Yeah, people are usually afraid of failure, but this is actually an essential phase. You try hard at something, and you don't get there. And so, what do? You go to phase number three. You take a rest. You do something else. And in that phase, that leads to, or can lead to, inspiration, which comes out of nowhere. It's, you know, true creativity is not something you do or make happen or control into existence. Doing happens in the first section, the first part of the creative act, but the inspiration comes unbidden, spontaneously, later on, when you're resting, after you've failed. And then what the last phase is taking that creative inspiration and weaving it into your next doing phase, right? So integrating what you've learned, integrating that stroke of insight into the next creative time.
Wow.
Your book, it's huge, 450 pages. It's got 14 chapters, but I want you to tell us about this one that kind of strikes me.
Sure.
Called The Yoga of Art.
The Yoga of Art. Yeah. Yeah, so that one, what is yoga? Yeah, yoga is a Sanskrit term that means union. And it's related to our words junction, to bring something together, or to yoke. You know, you yoga a cattle. I say all that because understanding what this word means, yoga is not necessarily just something you do in your Lululemon, you know, spandex, you're doing a bunch of different poses, you know, a nice workout with stretches. That's a very, very narrow form of what yoga can be. And really, it's just like the prelude to what yoga is. Yoga is the reunifying parts of yourself. And the reason this is important is because we tend to split ourselves off from ourselves, from the world around us, like the part of you that wants to do something and the part of you that doesn't. the your even your sense of self. If you know, for so many of it, it feels like I'm inside here and that's the world out there. There are these splits, but the real magic in life and in creativity only happens when you heal those splits. The split between mind and body. Like, this is what got healed for me in the Alexander technique. Before, I felt like, this was an embodied experience, it felt like I was up in my head controlling my body, making my body do things. And that led to all this tension and injuries and strain. But what the Alexander technique showed me was that, no. I mean, mind and body are distinct experiences, like as thoughts and as physical sensations, but I'm a unified being. We're all unified beings. We're like one whole being. And if I think of, you know, my mind against my body, then I'm always going to be struggling. I'm never going to be as creative or as flowing as I can be. But if I think of myself as being unified, then, you know, my thoughts affect my body. I notice the way my body affects my thoughts. And I suddenly tap into a much richer experience of being alive, a much richer experience of creating.
So you obviously took time to write the book. I'm sure you did research, looked within yourself, mm-hmm. and all that. Mm-hmm. Now that you've written the book and it's out for the world to see, do you have any personal takeaways? I mean, lessons learned, any kind of personal takeaways, you know, after in the aftermath of writing the book?
Don't write a book. No. Where is that coming from? It was a lot of work.
Yeah.
And I'm not eager to write another one, although I do have an idea for what to write next. I finished writing everything in June, and man, I was just exhausted.
How many years was it?
It was 3 years.
3 years.
Which for some people is not a long time. You know, for some books, it takes 20 years or a whole lifetime. Big takeaways. Oh, you know, I got so much clearer on who I am and what I'm about and what this process, this Soulforce Arts process is in the process of writing. You know, I knew what I wanted to write going in. This book is based on so many life experiences, teaching, playing, creating, exploring, you know, personal growth and spirituality. And so I had pretty much everything I knew, like the content of what I wanted to share already in me. But that didn't mean I knew how to write a book. And it didn't mean that I was perfectly clear on everything. And I'm just amazed at how the process of learning to become a writer and learning how to organize everything into this cohesive manuscript clarified my own thinking, clarified my own approach to creativity so much. Like so many times during this process, I realized, oh, I'm writing this book for myself. I really need to learn these lessons.
With our last minute left, any last words for the audience?
Yeah. So many artists have a secret fear that our art doesn't really matter in today's world. And you know, our society tells us this in so many different ways. So the arts are the first thing to be cut from schools. And you know, our society tells us that the arts are kind of like a luxury, a hobby. But I wrote this book to affirm the knowledge that your heart already has, that the arts have a vital, profound, tangible purpose in this world. And the world needs your soul force.
Joseph Arnold, author, violinist extraordinaire, here on All Entertainment Live, and with my co-host Anna Monaco, would like for you to join me in thanking Mr. Arnold.
Thank you so much.
Oh, it's been a pleasure
for being here. And I just wanted to tell everyone, the first three people to email Jerry at All Entertainment LLC, that's Jerry at allentertainmentllc.com, gets a free signed copy of the book. The first three people to email Jerry, and we'll check that later on today or tomorrow, and we'll send Joseph the names and your addresses and stuff. But
yeah, that's great.
Do it.
Yeah.
Do it.
Okay.
Get a book.
And just my URL is soulforcearts.com. You can check out my events and upcoming programs and the book and all that there. Soulforcearts.com.
All right. See you guys next week for another edition of All Entertainment Live.